Hey everybody, welcome back to our Wonder Read Aloud. Happy Monday. You can see today I'm in sunny downtown Rochester, New York. This thing over here is what's known as High Falls. So again, I'm doing this read aloud with the express written permission of the author. And I will get rid of these videos as soon as we go back to school. So we are starting today part 5 of the book, which is being told from Justin's point of view. There are 8 short chapters in the Justin's point of view section until we go back to the book being told from Augie's point of view. So, of course, every section starts with a song quote, and this one is actually not from a song. It's from a book called The Elephant Man, by Bernard Pomerantz. And so this is a quote from a character in that book named John Merrick. And the quote is, "Sometimes I think my head is so big because it's so full of dreams." Okay, so the first chapter in the Justin section, being told from Justin's point of view, is Olivia's brother. The first time I met Olivia's little brother, I have to admit, I'm totally taken by surprise. I shouldn't be, of course. Olivia told me about his syndrome, has even described what he looks like, but she's also talked about all of his surgeries over the years. So I guess I assumed he'd be more normal looking. Like when a kid is born with a cleft lip and has plastic surgery to fix it, sometimes you can't even tell except for the little scar above the lip. I guess I thought her brother would have some scars here and there, but not this. I definitely wasn't expecting to see this little kid in a baseball cap who's sitting in front of me right now. Actually, there are 2 kids sitting in front of me. One is a totally normal looking kid with curly blonde hair named Jack. The other is Augie. I like to think I'm able to hide my surprise. I hope I do. Surprise is one of those emotions that can be hard to fake. Though whether you're trying to look surprised when you're not, or trying to not look surprised when you are. I shake his hand. I shake the other kid's hand. Don't want to focus on his face. "Cool room," I say. "Are you Via's boyfriend?" he says. I think he's smiling. Olivia pushes down his baseball cap. "Is that a machine gun?" the blonde kid asks. Like I haven't heard that one before. And we talk about Zydeco for a bit. And then Via's taking my hand and leading me out of the room. As soon as we close the door behind us, we hear them laughing. "I'm from Brooklyn," one of them sings. Olivia rolls her eyes as she smiles. "Let's go hang out in my room," she says. We've been dating for 2 months now. I knew from the moment I saw her, the minute she sat down at our table in the cafeteria, that I liked her. Couldn't keep my eyes off her, really. Really beautiful, with olive skin and the bluest eyes I've ever seen in my life. At first, she acted like she only wanted to be friends. I think she kind of gives off that vibe without ever meaning to. "Stay back. Don't even bother." She doesn't flirt like some other girls do. She looks you right in the eye when she talks to you, like she's daring you. So I just keep looking her right in the eye too, like I was daring her right back. And then I asked her out, and she said yes, which rocked. She's an awesome girl, and I love hanging out with her. She didn't tell me about August until our 3rd date. I think she used the phrase a craniofacial abnormality to describe his face. Or maybe it was craniofacial anomaly. I know the one word she didn't use was deformed, though, because that word would have registered with me. "So what did you think?" she asks me nervously the second we're inside her room. "Are you shocked?" "No," I lie. She smiles and looks away. "You're shocked." "I'm not," I assure her. "He's just like what you said he'd be." She nods and plops down on her bed. Kind of cute how she still has a lot of stuffed animals on her bed. She takes one of them, a polar bear, without thinking, and puts it in her lap. I sit down on the rolling chair by her desk. Her room is immaculate, When I was little, she says, there were lots of kids who never came back for a second plating. I mean, lots of kids. I even had friends who wouldn't come to my birthday because he would be there. They never actually told me this, but it would get back to me. Some people just don't know how to deal with Augie, you know? I know. It's not even like they know they're being mean, she adds. They were just scared. I mean, let's face it. His face is a little scary, right? I guess, I answer. But you're okay with it? She asks me sweetly. You're not too freaked out or scared? I'm not freaked out or scared, I smile. She nods and looks down at the polar bear on her lap. I can't tell whether she believes me or not. But she gives the polar bear a kiss on the nose and tosses it to me with a little smile. I think that means she believes me, or at least she wants to. The next chapter, Valentine's Day. I give Olivia a heart necklace for Valentine's Day, and she gives me a messenger bag she made out of old floppy disks. Very cool how she makes things like that. Earrings out of pieces of circuit boards, dresses out of t-shirts, bags out of old jeans. She's so creative. I tell her she should be an artist someday, but she wants to be a scientist, a geneticist of all things. She wants to find cures for people like her brother, I guess. We make plans for me to finally meet her parents, a Mexican restaurant on Amesford Avenue near her house on Saturday night. All day long, I'm nervous about it. And when I get nervous, my tics come out. I mean, my tics are always there, but they're not like they used to be when I was little. Nothing but a few hard blinks now. The occasional head pull. But when I'm stressed, they get worse. And I'm definitely stressing about meeting her folks. They're waiting inside when I get to the restaurant. The dad gets up and shakes my hand, and the mom gives me a hug. I give Augie a hello fist punch and kiss Olivia on the cheek before I sit down. It's so nice to meet you, Justin. We've heard so much about you. Her parents couldn't be nicer. Put me at ease right away. The waiter brings over the menus, and I noticed his expression the moment he lays eyes on August. But I pretend not to notice. I guess we're all pretending not to notice things tonight. The waiter, my tics, the way August crushes the tortilla chips on this table and spoons the crumbs into his mouth. I look at Olivia and she smiles at me. She knows. She sees the waiter's face. She sees my tics. Olivia is a girl who sees everything. We spend the entire dinner talking and laughing. Olivia's parents ask me about my music, how I got into the fiddle and stuff like that. And I tell them about how I used to play classical violin, but I got into Appalachian folk music and then Zydeco. And they're listening to every word like they're really interested. They tell me to let them know the next time my band's playing a gig so they can come and listen. I'm not used to all the attention, to be truthful. My parents don't have a clue about what I want to do in my life. They never ask. We never talk like this. I don't think they even know I traded my Baroque violin for an 8-string hardanger fiddle 2 years ago. After dinner, we go back to Olivia's for some ice cream. Their dog greets us at the door. An old dog, super sweet. She'd thrown up all over the hallway, though. Olivia's mom rushes to get paper towels while the dad picks the dog up like she's a baby. "What's up, old girlie?" he says. And the dog's in heaven, tongue hanging out, tail wagging, legs in the air at awkward angles. "Dad, tell Justin how you got daisies," says Olivia. "Yeah," says Augie. Dad smiles and sits down in a chair with the dog still cradled in his arms. It's obvious he's told this story lots of times, and they all love to hear it. "So I'm coming home from the subway one day," he says, "and a homeless guy I've never seen in this neighborhood before is pushing this floppy mutt in a stroller. He comes up to me and says, 'Hey, mister, want to buy my dog?' And without even thinking about it, I say, 'Sure, how much you want?' And he says, 10 bucks. So I give him the $20 I have in my wallet, and he hands me the dog. Justin, I'm telling you, you've never smelled anything so bad in your life. She stank so much, I can't even tell you. So I took her right from there to the vet down the street, and then I brought her home." "Didn't even call me first, by the way," the mom interjects. as she cleans the floor, to see if I'm okay with his bringing home some homeless guy's dog. The dog actually looks over at the mom when she says this, like she understands everything everyone is saying about her. She's a happy dog, like she knows she lucked out that day finding this family. I kind of know how she feels. I like Olivia's family. They laugh a lot. My family's not like this at all. My mom and dad got divorced when I was 4, and they pretty much hate each other. I grew up spending half of every week in my dad's apartment in Chelsea, and the other half in my mom's place in Brooklyn Heights. I have a half-brother who's 5 years older than me and barely knows I exist. For as long as I can remember, I felt like my parents could hardly wait for me to be old enough to take care of myself. You can go to the store by yourself. Here's the key to the apartment. It's funny how there's a word like overprotective to describe some parents, but no word that means the opposite. What word do you use to describe parents who don't protect enough? Underprotective? Neglectful? Self-involved? Lame? All of the above. Olivia's family tell each other, "I love you," all the time. I can't remember the last time anyone in my family said that to me. By the time I go home, my tics have all stopped. All right, so I think we're going to stop there for today. We will pick up with the Justin section next time. Thanks for listening.